It's a privilege to be here moderating this session with Harsh on his latest book, Fatal Accidents. I read this book last night, and it's very ironical for two reasons. One, I read it on Kindle, and this is something which I have not done. I don't do very often, so I'm not sure whether I'll be asking the right questions because I read it on Kindle. The second thing, the second reason why I find it ironical is that here I am reading a book on Kindle, bookmarking it left, right, and center, and hoping it'll the highlights will throw up. Oh, sorry. But the stories in them could have been written 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 50 years ago, and nothing much has changed. And that for me is the irony, that we are here in 2017, and this is, I've read Harsh's books, all his books before, and I suspect that this book, I recommend to all of you, will give you the maximum number of sleepless nights. And we will be going through a few aspects of the book in the next 45 minutes, or maybe 35 minutes, and we can have questions. And it's a privilege to be here to introduce Harsh's. It's not very difficult. His profile is all over Wikipedia and all over the press and all over the internet. But I will just mention four initiatives with which he is associated. One is on Aman Biradari, where it's an initiative on secularism, peace, and one is on Nyayagad, on legal justice and communal violence. One is on Dilse, it's an initiative for street children. And one is Hosla, for urban homeless people. His books, all of them are splendid. The latest one is what we'll be discussing today. Thank you.
Friends, I am delighted to be here and to see some loved and respected faces in the audience as well. The title of my book is Fatal Accidents of Birth, and it is drawn from a letter that a young man wrote a little over a year ago in this city, before he felt compelled to take his life. He would have been 28 years old tomorrow. He said, "I could not escape the fatal accident of my birth." And therefore, in homage to his memory, I decided to title my book Fatal Accidents of Birth. It's a story, it's 17 stories of 17 people who could not escape the fatal accident of their births, including Rohit Vemmela. I had invited his mother and Radhika for releasing the book in Delhi, and she was with me, and she said something at the launch which once again broke my heart. She said she struggled all her life in the hope that her sons would be able to study hard and go to university, and you know, he was a PhD scholar. But now, after what happened to Rohit, her only advice for her younger son is do anything but don't go to university. And she's happier that he's driving an auto rickshaw. She feels that he's safer driving an auto rickshaw than in a university. And I think we need to reflect what has happened. And when she said this, some friends told me that a number of mothers of Muslim young students are giving the same advice after Najib's disappearance in JNU. Do anything, but are you safe in our universities? So I just thought I'd quickly read out the preface of my book and it would indicate why, what the book is about and why it is dedicated in what ways to Rohit. I have never known the disdain of teachers who believe I am undeserving of a future because I was born without merit. I have never been beaten because I aspire to worship in a temple that people say would be defiled by my step or my touch or my veneration. I have never been humiliated every day of my life because I was born into a caste that other people regard to be unclean. I have not known what it is to cower as mobs, armed with daggers and light bulbs full of acid, raise terrifying slogans calling for my head and the blood of my loved ones, for the crime that I and others like me follow a faith different from theirs, to helplessly watch my children burn alive, the girls and women of my family raped, to see my family, my home, my work, my life savings, my entire world destroyed forever in a matter of hours, all for this one crime. I have never been ostracized and abandoned because I unknowingly contracted an incurable ailment. I have never been shunned because I chose to sell my body to raise my children with dignity. I have never been banished from a world because I could not accept the gender into which my body was born. I have never been jailed with my only little son left outside and no one in the world to care for him. I have never slept hungry a single night because I didn't have the money or work. Far less have I known the desperation of not being able to feed my loved ones, of realizing that the only way I could ensure that my children live is to send them away to labor in fields, to wash utensils in an eatery, or to give them away to someone who might be able to raise them. I cannot imagine the helplessness of a homeless woman who, for 20 years, has had to sleep night after night on pavements, unable to stop strange men from molesting and raping her. I cannot imagine being locked up for years in a beggar's home only because my legs are malformed and I have no place to sleep other than on the streets. I do not know what I would do if my daughter was killed by the police after her death, labeled by the country's establishment as a terrorist, a suicide bomber. Or if my husband was gunned down by militants and the army insisted that my 13-year-old son was a terrorist. These are some of the stories I try to tell in this volume, stories which might seem unimaginable but are true. None of these stories could be mine. They could never be my stories, and for only one reason, because the accident of my birth was not fatal, as it was for Rohit Vemula, or tragic, as it was for all those others whose stories this book tells. These can never be my stories, or possibly yours, but these are stories we must listen to, stories we must heed. For far too long have we looked away, and now we must answer the question Bob Dylan posed when he sang, "How many times can a man turn his head, pretending he just doesn't see? Yes, and how many years must one man have before he can hear people cry? Yes, and how many deaths will it take till he knows that too many people have died?" These are bleak, harrowing stories, but also ones of resistance and dignity. Far better than my telling them would have been for you to have heard them directly from the people whose lives these are. I hope you will be able to do that one day, not too distant. But for the present, we still live in a world, one which we have ourselves created, where we can fly to other planets, but light years seem to separate us from those who live with and battle the worst oppressions and cruelties. However, the truth is that the distance between human beings is no greater than the elementary recognition of our equal human dignity. I have tried to work as a peace and justice worker and chronicler for over 15 years after I left the civil service in 2002. Over that decade and a half, I have had the privilege to meet the people I've gathered here, I've told here. I tell their stories. I know that I'm an imperfect vessel to carry these stories to you, as my earth has not been baked in the same harsh sun as those whose stories these are. The failures will be many, but I'm responsible for them. I've also told the more recent stories of people who found their ways into the headlines, into the public consciousness. For instance, the juvenile who participated in the horrendous rape of 16 December 2002 in Delhi. And he was spared the gallows and became India's most hated. I could not have known Ishrat Jahan killed as a teenage girl of 19 in a police encounter, but I have met her mother and younger sister in the course of their dogged and brave battles. And of course, the doctoral scholar from the University of Hyderabad, Rohit Vemula, whose passing tore open our hearts because it laid bare once again the truth of the cruelties and the consequences of our unjust world. In his first and last letter to the world, Rohit Vemula wrote, "Some people, for them, life itself is a curse. My birth is my fatal accident." His is one of the most damning and painful indictments of the India and the world which we have crafted together. A country and a world where the lives and destinies of millions of women and men, young people, boys and girls, still continue to be determined only by the fatal accidents of their birth, not by the breadth of their hearts, the glint of their minds, the grit of their endeavors, the mettle of their characters, and the flight of their dreams. This book is dedicated, therefore, in atonement and in love to the memory of Rohit Vemula and to all the Rohit Vemulas whom we continue to fail with the world we do not build.
Friends, it is one of the most powerful prefaces I've read in many, many years. But the first story I would like us to talk to us about is the story of Ashok Mochi. And there's a line there, it was Aman Biradari, an initiative which he heads. There's a line which I really like, which says that, "Aman, they measure the success by engaging the perpetrators in the criminal justice system." So, all of us must read the story of Ashok Mochi to understand one or two things: that was Ashok Mochi guilty, or can mass guilt ever be punished at all adequately? I want you to tell a few aspects of that story.
Those of you, one of the iconic photographs of the Gujarat massacre is of this young man with his hand raised with a saffron ribbon around his head. All of you would have seen that picture. It became symbolic of the Gujarat massacre. I thought I'd like to know 15 years later, where is this young man? What is happening to him? What is his life like? It was a particularly difficult encounter because in our work in Niyayagriha, we were trying to pursue legal justice for all people who wanted to fight those who had been affected by the riots. And one of the people whom we actually pursued in the courts was, one of the accused was this man, Ashok Mochi, and his picture was there everywhere around the world. So he was actually somebody we pursued in order to hold accountable for the crimes of Gujarat 2002. But I believe that compassion has to be thoroughgoing and empathy. And I did want to understand at least some the foot soldiers of the violence and what happened with them into their lives. So we sought out this man, and I discovered the story which I've written here. He's a homeless man still. He's a cobbler, that's why Ashok Mochi, he repairs shoes on a street corner in Ahmedabad. He sleeps still on the pavement. He never married. Over the years, I say in the story that he claims that he did not, he didn't really participate in the crimes of that morning of February 28th. I say, I will never know, but my guess is that he probably did. But over the years, he reflects very little hatred of the Muslim community. He's just struggling to lead some kind of life of dignity for himself. And one of the remarkable things that happened was that on the 10th anniversary, some left students in Kerala decided to invite him and the other iconic face of the riots, which was this person begging for to be saved. The two of them were invited together to share a platform in Kerala. And they lived in the same room. And they became very close friends. One of the reports says that when they were there in this large audience in Kerala, and the two men decided to sing an old Hindi film song dedicated to communal harmony, both of them sang completely out of key. No one in the audience understood a word of what they were singing, and yet everybody was in tears. And he tells me that the one house where he is now welcome is this new friend of his. So he goes to this Muslim tailor's house as a friend once in a while. He says, "I'm homeless, so I can't invite him back." But this is really the world in all its complexities. Who is a villain? Who is a perpetrator? Who is a victim? I think often the lines are very, very blurred between them. That is why I thought I'd tell this story.
There is this other story, the Muzaffar Nagar riots. You titled it Lost Forever. I thought if you were titled it The Chronicle of a Death Foretold, it would have been more appropriate. There you write a sentence that is a public acknowledgement of the agony, injustice and disposition. And you're talking about Rahim's voice. Muzaffar Nagar is only a 3-year-old riot. And when you had researched, when you had spoken to them, it must have been very, very fresh. Do you see that very different from what you saw in Godhra?
On the contrary, because, you know, I saw the suffering close up in riots, 1984, and the riots during the Babri Masjid movement. As a district collector, as an IAS officer, and I was, you know, devastated by the kind of suffering that hate, the politics of hate, how it destroys Nagar. And there's something that really strikes me, and that is how, the suffering caused by the wounds, and I call them somewhere the soul wounds, that are caused by hate violence are much harder to heal than almost any other violence. Now suppose, for instance, I lost my entire family in an earthquake or in a tsunami. The suffering is huge, but I can come to terms with it at some point. But what I found with survivors who have lost have had the same losses, but they're caused by the hatred of their own neighbors, people they've grown up with. That is a kind of pain that somehow just doesn't heal. And I've told several stories, actually, 3 or 4 stories. I've talked about the survivor of the 84 riots of Gujarat. But this Muzaffar Nagar boy, because it is the most recent, He was 16 when this happened, and he tells this story, and this is one story which I then related in the first person exactly as he told it to me, because he really wanted to share what happened. And he said that, "I just don't know what happened. The Jats and the Muslims had lived together like brothers and sisters." He said, "We were neighbors, we were, you know, many things in a rural context. When there was a wedding, in one community, the other community would receive the guests, feed the guests, and so on. There are many things he talked about. He talked about in school. And then within a week, 10 days, they had decided that they're going to divide the community. And that story about a Muslim boy stalking a Jat girl, which led to this violence, turned out to be a completely false story. It didn't happen. But that's irrelevant now. But what is incredible is that it led to so much hatred. And Muzaffarnagar is a place where actually has not seen violence even during the peak periods of partition and the Babri Masjid movements, which were the two peak periods of communal hatred. Even then, there was no violence in this area. And we largely have large Jat landlords with poor Muslim workers, and a few large Muslim Jat landlords who also had got converted, who have largely Dalit workers. And the villages had these mixed communities living together with entire peace. And then suddenly, these people turned on them. So this boy, Rahim, I changed his name because he didn't want, he's still frightened for his name to be told. But he talks about how his grandfather, who's this patriarch, you know, the hatred started building up over those days. But he kept saying, nobody's going to, you know, how can anyone attack me? And he refused to move, and people kept saying, move, go to safety. He just wouldn't move, and he was the stubborn old patriarch, and he kept saying, no one can touch us. Will my neighbors kill me? Will they attack me, etc.? And finally, the night before the violence reached its peak, he finally, his heart broke, and he said, at least let the kids go. And that's why his life and the lives of his brothers and sisters and cousins got saved. And they walked through the night to the relief camp. But the next morning, the mobs came, they killed his grandfather, and they killed his grand aunt and various other older people. Because his father, the grandfather till the end, could not believe that they would be attacked. And he kept saying, but we were brothers and sisters. They're just, you know, where has that love gone? What has happened? How can there be so much hatred? And, you know, there are 50,000 people now who, in just those two districts, who were displaced at that time, who can never return. And they're living now in these self-settled colonies in really terrible conditions. We've just recently brought out a report on their condition. And, because I'd be working, I mean, my writing is only a part, an extension of the work that we do. So, when I go among them, I remember asking this question to them, why don't you go back to your village? And the answer that they repeatedly gave me, again, just tore apart my heart, and they said, koi bulaye tab to hum jayen. If somebody calls us back, then only we can go back. And here we have lived as neighbors and almost as family for generations. And this hatred is generated over a false incident. And now nobody has even turned back to call them to return back to their villages. And they say, they're waiting ke koi bulaye tab to hum jayen. This is his story.
We shift to Kashmir, where in the public discourse we always discuss why the pundits have been sent away from Kashmir, why they are not going back. But what you have written, Shamim's story, I think is an excellent story of another viewpoint as to what happens with people who are in Kashmir and what the forces of Kashmir who are against peace and harmony can do to thousands of families in Kashmir. And I think that's a different kind of a story which you have said from what we have discussed in Godhra and in Muzaffarnagar. I would like to know, is Shamim's story representative of the story of Kashmir itself?
Shamim, story is one that I think no party in the entire dispute would want to hear. I met her I spent about 15 days in Kashmir a few years ago, trying to understand again the human suffering. I went back again recently. But Shamima's story, she started off by telling me that there are many days when she feels that she should tie a large stone around her body and to jump into the cold waters of the Jhelum and never come out. But it is only her young sons and their future that is holding her back. Her story, very briefly, was that in 1890, her husband was a government servant. He used to disappear for long periods from the house, and she didn't know, she thought he was going on government work, that he had become a militant. And he crossed the borders, he got trained, he became a militant. 3-4 years passed, and then, as happens in a lot of the violent movements, they became factionalized, and there was bitter disputes between them. And his life was under threat from the rival militant groups. And he didn't know how, you know, he was very worried that they would kill him. So he took his wife, he confessed to his wife and took their advice, and they decided that perhaps it would be safest if he surrenders. So he surrendered. And the surrendered militants are the most hated in the local community. So after he surrendered, he tried to restart his life. But one day, some of the militant groups came and they pumped his leg, one of his legs, full with bullets. And then they sold all their land. They tried. She saved her husband's life, lost his leg, came back, and then she said, they put out advertisements in all the newspapers saying, we've asked for forgiveness from anybody about anything, just let us live. But that was not to be. And then and because he was a surrendered militant, they also became ostracized by the local community. So they were hated by everybody. The husband and the son was just 13 years old, he was ostracized as well. And one day the militant groups came, and again they came to their house. And at that stage, her husband said, I mean, I just can't go on like this. You have to kill me, just kill me in my chest. And so they killed him. And she was left down with this small 13-year-old son. The 13-year-old son felt he had to redeem himself because they were so ostracized in the community, that he went and joined the militant groups. But he was a 13-year-old boy, and he got terrified in a couple of weeks, and he ran back. Now, his family was not only a surrendered militant family, his son was now a militant, and therefore the security forces started harassing them. So they were ostracized in the community, the militant groups harassed them, the community hated them, and the security forces continue to harass them. The son lost his mind. That for me is the tragedy of life in Kashmir.
Thank you.
There are some stories in this book. They raise many questions on ethics, and very, very disturbing, as you notice that what we are doing in the last half hour. But one story of Lalita and Shyamlal, of selling my child. Frankly, this was in length, I think it's a much shorter story. But this is a question I think all of us have to ask ourselves in our own society. And obviously you didn't provide an answer. But I want you to tell us, isn't it a question of ethics, and which is beyond law?
One of the many things I've learned over the years working with people living extraordinarily difficult lives is not to judge. We sometimes read stories about somebody who sold their child, and I think that the reaction that most of us would have is that how terrible you know, what parents are these if they could sell their child. When I met this woman who had sold her child, I wanted to understand, so I'd gone, this is in the interiors of Orissa, I wanted to understand for myself. And this lady kept crying and she said, I love my child so much, that's why I sold her. Don't you understand? I love my child so much, that's why I sold her. And there's a long story about how Landis family, father migrating, bringing back some money, but then the father contracts a very serious ailment and then he's not able to earn and there's no money in the house. And they have this daughter. Somebody in the village who was distantly related but who had gotten to government service, I think become a BDO or something, and was relatively better off, said that, I don't have a daughter, can I take the daughter and I'll bring her up and I'll also help you resolve some of your debts. And they gave the daughter to her and in the hope that she would survive. Some journalist got some local journalists got track of this and issued this, you know, story that, look, this child has been sold. It became a big issue in the Orissa assembly. The entire assembly discussed it. A whole team of legislators came into this distant village, to this little hut, and they harangued this couple and said, aren't you ashamed of yourself, you sold your child. And she kept again saying, I loved my child, that's why I had to sell her. In any case, because of all of this, they registered a case against the man who had taken the child and forcefully separated the child and brought her back to these parents. I went about a year, I had read fragments of this story from the assembly. And that's why I just thought to understand reality, for me, stories, real life stories, are the best way to understand what is happening in our world. So I actually went and sought out, and when I went to see them, the most heartbreaking thing of it all was that child had died. They just could not, they didn't have the resources to save the child. So after all of this, the child was brought back to her biological parents and she died. That's the story.
Just three more stories. Two, of course, we'll discuss in some detail. But by the standards of the book, I can only say we have a delightful story. I don't mean it in that sense. Of the strange tale of sacrilege, a story of faith by Kishan Gopal. I think that you have to tell us this, what shall I say, this peculiar story. And his suffering is very different from the kind of suffering you talked about.
This is a man in a village close to, a Dalit man in a village close to Jaipur. We know that Dalits are not allowed to worship in temples. There was a temple in the village where he used to go with great devotion, but he knew his place and he would stand at the door of the temple and worship. And his son, who relates the story to me, says that he accepted his status as how Dalits are treated. But one day when he was doing this worship from a distance, some upper caste young men came and they insulted him at the temple and didn't even allow him to worship from there. And he said something cracked up in his head and he came home and they'd never seen him so agitated. And then he said, I am going to teach them all a lesson. And what did he decide to do? They were basically migrant workers. They were very, very poor. They used to go and work on this in construction sites in Jaipur, etc. They had very little money, but he had saved small amount of money to buy a piece of land. So his entire savings he decided to invest in building a very tall and statue of Hanumanji and to build a temple in the Dalit Mohalla of Hanumanji, which would be his. And so his entire life savings, everything went, and then how he went and bought this big statue, how it was brought, the whole village was in consternation. Now that has to be consecrated by a Brahmin in the whole thing. Now which Brahmin would be willing to do this? So he had to go to other districts and he paid a huge amount of money to some Brahmin who came and then consecrated this this statue of Hanuman. And then the upper caste people of the village were just stupefied at this act of rebellion, that they went into they started, there was complete violence, and they kept attacking this family. This guy then kept going to the police, and it's a long story, and some human rights people came in. So he got police protection, and there used to be a whole guard of 4 or 5 people who would stand with him and his Hanumanji statue and the village, and this one guy who was isolated. It's a very strange story actually. But at some point it got too much, and I relate that, and he couldn't hold out, and then the whole family was expelled from the village by the violence, and he died as a casual laborer. His family is unable to return. And I end up by saying, I wonder what this lone Hanumanji must be thinking in his village, where he's been left by his worshippers and by everybody else.
Two more stories, Ash. Both of them part of our of the consciousness of all of us here and in the entire country in one sense. But the first story of Ishrat Jan, you have represented it very, very differently. And well, all stories are disturbing. This is a story which is somehow very chilling, I should say. And I want you to be able to tell us how your viewpoint is, I mean, the way you presented in the story is so different from the fight, in any case, which we're all familiar with, about the fake encounter of Surabhadri. But you've told a different story also.
Yeah, once again, I wanted you to think, the older people in this room, what happens if suddenly one day you're told that not only has your 19-year-old daughter, your brightest child, has been gunned down by the police, but that she's a suicide bomber and a dreaded terrorist. And so what I've tried to do is of this family. Her father had died a little earlier, and she was the second oldest child, but in every family there's one child who becomes like the head. So she was 19 years old, there was very little money in the house, so she used to do tuition, she was studying in college, she was very bright, and so on. And largely through the tuitions was the family being held together. Summer vacations is a time when there's, when tuitions don't happen, and there was no money. Distantly, somebody known to the family came and said there's a small traveling sales job that is being offered. She has to go with this man. People have forever said, which Muslim mother would send her daughter on a traveling job. I mean, I think that you need to realize how, when you have to survive, you have to make difficult choices. And so her mother did agree to this, and so she joined this sales job. And 10 days after she joined this, suddenly, they didn't know. They didn't have a television in the house, and they didn't know. And they were sitting in the house, and in the evening, this group of journalists come in, and they realize that the family doesn't know, and they don't know what to say. But they want desperately the picture to put up on television. So they claim to be from her college, and they say they need her picture for some passport picture for some form. And so the picture that we saw also on television was taken in this way from the family. Then about 8-9 in the evening, they were suddenly told that this had happened. The younger children said they hadn't even heard of that she was out to kill Narendra Modi. They said they didn't even know who Narendra Modi was, and they couldn't imagine that this had happened. And then how the family, the whole police came, the house was sealed, the mother was taken to Gujarat. She saw this body of her 19-year-old child. And then they were completely ostracized because they had no time even to grieve or the family to survive, because the stigma of being the parents of a suicide bomber. And they had no hope of actually redeeming that child's reality. Then what happens, life, it's extraordinary. The hero of this story really is an unknown junior magistrate. Every encounter killing is actually investigated under law by a magistrate. And 99.9% of these magistrates just sign off on the dotted line. Here's this junior, his Sikkimese origin, Tamang his name. I don't even know what he looks like, I've tried to find out. But this guy did his investigation and he knew how explosive it was. He wrote a few hundred pages with hand, but he built up an extremely powerful case which cannot be refuted about how this was not an encounter killing. It was completely fake encounter, that the four of them had been brought in a car, they'd made to stand from close range, they'd been killed. He established that completely. Now this report came out, and the family told me how on that day it was poignant because they started distributing sweets. They were distributing sweets after your daughter's death, but they were distributing sweets because for the first time they could hold their heads high and say, no, my daughter was not a terrorist, and so on. And then they started fighting the case, and other lawyers started helping them, and they continue to fight this. But I end up with this recent thing where suddenly former Home Secretary Gopal Pillai, for whom I actually had quite a lot of regard, he and some other, and that David Headley, suddenly said that no, she was a Lashkar-e-Toyba activist. Now, the evidence, and the police officer who investigated this case has also been sent to Kalapani, Satish Verma. I'm in touch with him. Again, a very brave person who is now in Tripura. His government is harassing him because he told the truth again in this case. But he was telling me that the total number of days since they were first introduced and when she was killed was about 40 days, of which 30 days the college records show that she was studying in college. Now in 10 days, no human being can be recruited, trained, brainwashed, and developed into a suicide bomber. It was just an impossibility. So as a result, but Mr. Gopal Pillai said the most horrible thing, and although he's a friend, I've written about him in saying that I'm so disappointed, that he actually said, no, the hotel records show that she was sleeping in the same room Javed, who was the person who had employed her. Now, if that's true, and the police officer says that you can always fudge these records, but even if it was true, it is an irrelevant fact. You don't treat working women with this disrespect. It's irrelevant whether she slept in the same room or not. But that is now how they're trying to taint her all these years later, to say she's a terrorist. And the family is actually fighting still to prove that she was innocent.
So I just want you to finally take us to what is the message you have got to us in the story of Rohit Vemmela.
See, Rohit Vemmela, I think his, again, a letter that he scribbled just before he took his life, was a letter that has moved millions of us across, and it moved us for many reasons. Because he was obviously a very bright young man. He had many dreams. He dreamt of being a science writer like Carl Sagan, he dreamt of the stars. He thought every human being was made up of stardust. But he said with all of that, he could not escape the fatal accident of his birth. I believe that that one line is the most powerful indictment of everything that we have done and not done as a people in the 70 years of India's independence. That we continue to be a country in which millions of people cannot escape. We are all in this room here largely because of the accidents of our birth, non-fatal accidents, the good accidents. We chose our parents well. That's why we got a good education, we got good nutrition, we were clever in that. But people who have not been able to choose their parents so cleverly have had and continue to face, and as I said, it's not the breath of your heart, the glint of your mind, the flight of your dreams, how hard you work, nothing of that, the strength of your character, none of that matters. All that matters is the accident of your birth. And I think it was that, and Carl Sagan's wife actually was sent this letter, and she said something that is really very moving, because she said that his letter is a reminder once again about all the potential that human civilization has lost because of prejudice. You know, every time when you go out on the streets and you see somebody on a construction site, you see somebody cleaning your toilet, how do you know if this person had half a chance in life? That person might have been a poet, a philosopher, a scientist, a writer, a social worker. How do we know what we are collectively losing because we have still built this world where our destinies are still determined only by the accidents of our birth? And it is in that context that I dedicated this book to Rohit's melody. For the world that we have not been able to build.
Thank you. Thank you, Harsh. Thank you for those wonderful, wonderful, I know the right adjective, for those 17 stories. I'm sure that there are still 17 million stories remaining to be told. And it would be great for this country when we don't have such stories to be told. We'll be waiting for that. And thank you very much for writing such a great book.